we normally do with a moment of silent prayer, if necessary, to utilize 1 John 1:9, the rebound technique, which is the confession of our sins, where we have the cleansing of our vessel, and when the cleansed vessel, we have fellowship with God, which is also synonymous with the filling of God, the Holy Spirit. So with a moment of silent prayer, if necessary, let us pray. And Heavenly Father, we just thank you again for this day, another day to live on this earth, to glorify you, to worship you now through the study of your word also, and to serve you in all that we do. And Father, we can't thank you enough for all that you have given to us, our own personal salvation, your spirit that empowers us and enables us, your word that gives us strength to go forward, to overcome the problems and details of life, and to live each day unto you with vigor and excitement, inner peace and happiness. And Father, we ask that you continue to watch over our nation, continue to provide for the freedoms that we have so that we as a client nation can continue to glorify you in all that we do. Be with the leaders in civilian and military, civilian government and also our military to help them to make decisions that are in line with your word and especially your divine establishment principles. We also pray for our military that does stand on guard on our behalf around the world as we get ready to celebrate them this weekend. We thank you for all that have ever served and are currently serving. We thank you for their service and for their sacrifice, and we ask that you be with those, especially in harm's way this day in Afghanistan and throughout the world. And we ask that you be with them, protect and guide them according to your will. We ask that you bring healing to those who have been wounded, either physically or spiritually, and also bring healing to the loved ones who have lost, or to those who have lost loved ones in our current campaigns in Iraq and Afghanistan. We ask that you comfort their souls with your word and with your spirit. And we thank you, Father, for those who have given their lives for their service and for their sacrifice. So, Father, we thank you again for this day, and we ask that you help us to lift up our hearts in song and in praise, and also in concentration on your word. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, by the power of your Spirit, we pray. Amen. All right, if you'll rise for our doxology. Anyway, just gonna give me a second. I gotta get this guy. That other tune always comes to my mind because I've sung that one for hundreds of years. I'm not that old, right? Somebody give me the tune. All right, got it. And a one, and a two, and a three. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Faster, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. One more time. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Amen, and please be seated. I think one of these coming Sundays, we'll have to sing that song, the full song, so we get the right cadence to that, because for some reason, everybody wants to go so slow, and it's a faster song than that, so let's just pick it up a little more. So I remember when John and Emily sang it, it was a lot faster, so, and that's the way I like it. All right, so we'll do it fast. All right, so moving on, let's turn in our Bibles to Proverbs chapter 14, Proverbs 14. And as you know, we ought to trust in the Lord with all our heart and do not lean on our own understanding. And tonight we are finishing up, as we began to finish up on Tuesday, the second section of Proverbs 14, which encompasses verses 8 through 15. And tonight we're going to finish up the exegesis and the messages that we have with verse 15 and then get into a good summary for the conclusion of this overall section, verses 8 through 15. So as we look back at verse 15, let's turn there again in our Bibles, Proverbs chapter 14, verse 15. It says, the naive believes everything, but the prudent man considers his step. And so here we have the naive one. We've seen this individual before. This is what is called the gullible individual, and we're going to see him in contrast to the shrewd, or what we would say the prudent individual. Again, the naive believes everything, but the prudent man considers his steps. So when we talk about that naive individual, it's our Hebrew word pethi, which we've noted throughout the book of Proverbs several times before. especially in Proverbs chapter 1, 7, 8, and 9. It means a simple one, a young individual, somebody that is immature, we would say, doesn't have a lot of worldly experience, doesn't have a lot of knowledge, and therefore they are naive. Again, they don't know everything as of yet. And it's kind of like the young adult or the young teenager, I should say, who thinks they know everything, even though they've only been living with mommy and daddy for, 15 to 16 years of their life, and then all of a sudden they think they know all the answers to life and life situations. But yet they've never been out there experiencing life, they've never been on their own, and they really haven't had to face the trials and tribulations of everyday life. And typically, mom and dad is taking care of those things. But they think they know everything. This is the naive one that we're talking about. The individual who just does not have, in the spiritual realm, they just don't have a lot of Bible doctrine as of yet. They don't have a lot of experience in the spiritual life. And sometimes that can be very detrimental to them, especially if they don't have humility within their soul. Humility to recognize, hey, I don't know everything. Humility to recognize there are people that do know more about life and life situations and know more about doctrine and the plan of God than I do. There are people who are more mature, more experienced, and more rounded in Bible doctrine than I am. And that's what they need to recognize. But the arrogance inside the soul of this young type of believer, or the naive one, typically wants them to think that they can go out and conquer life situations all by themselves, conquer the world, slay the dragon, slay Satan, and then just go out and fight for the Lord each and every day. But ultimately, if they do, they are going to be in a lot of trouble and a lot of difficulty because they don't have the strength, they don't have the wisdom, they don't have the experience to know what to do. They are inexperienced. Experienced, and as a result of that, they are easily seduced. And that's what a pethy individual is all about. They are easily seduced. They easily can give over to various temptations. They easily can go, as we're going to see a little bit later on, they blow with every wind of doctrine that is blowing in the air. And they say, oh, well, this sounds good, and that sounds right, so I'll go in that direction. And then another day, oh, that sounds right, and that sounds good, so I'll go in that direction. And they float and flutter in the spiritual realm rather than continuing to march forward, rather than recognizing there are individuals that are around them, the wise sage or the wise individual that has much more experience and knowledge than they do, and then following their lead. These individuals can be easily seduced to get into all kinds of false doctrines, as it were, or even when we just talk about the believer in regard to living in Satan's cosmic system, get involved in all kinds of wrong types of mentality, wrong types of thinking. And as we've noted, it may seem right to them in their own mind, but yet its way is all wrong. And so this is the type of individual that does need further instruction. And so as new believers, if you're a new believer or if you're a maturing believer, again, you always need to recognize and humble yourself. I don't know it all. And there are people wiser than me, and I should follow their lead. And certainly the Word of God is much wiser than all of us combined. And therefore, we need the Word of God in our lives. And we need to take it in and consistently be learning it and then also applying it as we go forward. But the naive individual, again, that's what's in view here. And unfortunately, this is the individual that says believes everything. And so believes everything. This word believe, we've talked about this. I'll show you that in a minute. Aman is the Hebrew word. It's similar to amen in the Greek, and also transliterated into the English, but it means what is true or what they believe to be true. And here we see that they believe everything. And as I showed you before, that word everything is really in the Hebrew, it's the word dava, and it means every word. It also can mean a thing or a matter, but literally it means every word. In other words, they're believing everything they hear. And they don't have discernment yet because they don't have enough doctrine. And they're not applying the principles that they've learned in the Word of God. And because they don't know enough of the Word of God, they're just believing what someone else says because it sounds good. And they can present it in such a way. And believe you me, and all of you have seen it, and all of you know that there are individuals out there that can utilize the Scripture to make a point, yet that point is all wrong. And it's a false doctrine, and it's completely counter to the truth of God's Word. Anybody can take one or two principles or sentences from the Scripture and make a doctrine and make you think that it's right. But yet, if they don't combine it, Scripture Scripture with Scripture and look at the totality of the Scripture with divine viewpoint and dispensational theology behind that, again, they're going to be interpreting the Scriptures all wrong. So what we see here is an individual that is walking by sight. They are lacking discernment that comes through experience. They tend to be too trusting in these situations and just believing everything that they hear or everything that they see. And also they are unable to distinguish between good counsel and bad counsel. They have a very difficult time in doing that. And that's why Solomon is warning his young son. That's why God is warning all of us as believers as we are going forward. He's warning us, have discernment. Learn what the Word of God has to say so you'll be able to discern between what is right and what is wrong. The false doctrine from the truth. The cosmic viewpoint from the divine viewpoint. We need to make those decisions and have that discernment in our lives each and every day. And ultimately, again, they won't be able to distinguish and they will fail to learn from their experiences. And this type of individual also doesn't learn and they repeat the same problems or errors in their life over and over and over again. And the arrogance complex of sins and arrogance complex of our soul will lead us to make us think that, oh, I'm right, I don't need doctrine or I don't need to learn that principle or I don't need to listen to that person. And we just keep making the same errors over and over and over again. And God doesn't want us to be that way. He doesn't want us to be that type of individual that's blowing with every wind of doctrine. And when we talk about every wind of doctrine, and this will come into play also on Sunday, you know, and I've said it already, but let me say it again. We're not just talking about what the Scriptures have to say. Okay, every wind of doctrine means whatever the cosmic system is putting out there is right in the world today. And as we know, you know, how many states? 17 states have condoned homosexual marriages. Yet the Word of God says that that is absolutely wrong. But yet 17 states in our country are saying it's right, and our federal government is trying to have that for the entire country. But yet it is something that is absolutely wrong. You see, that is a wind of doctrine, a doctrine that is coming from Satan's cosmic system, a doctrine that is counter to what the Word of God ultimately has to say. And so we can't just go along and believe it. And unfortunately, our children today are being indoctrinated within their schools from elementary on up to say it's okay to have a homosexual relationship. It's okay to have a gay marriage. But yet it is absolutely all wrong. It's completely wrong. And again, that's an easy one to point to because it's right out there. But there are all kinds of winds of doctrine that come from Satan's cosmic system that are telling us, do something that is counter to the will and plan and the Word of God for your life. Just like when Satan came into the Garden of Eden. Again, God said, don't eat of the fruit of the knowledge from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The wind of doctrine from Satan said, oh, you can do it. It'll be good for you. It's okay. You'll be wiser for doing it. Again, that was a wind of doctrine. And yet the naive one, Eve, just followed along into line. And then the arrogant one, Adam, came along and ate it intentionally as a result. So again, we see how problems and difficulties can arise, how it takes us outside of God's plan for our lives. And we should never want to be categorized as the naive one. We should be categorized as someone who has integrity, someone that has humility, someone that has discernment in our lives. And if we don't know what the right answer is, we seek out the wise sages within our lives. We seek out the wise counsel of the spiritually mature or even our pastor teacher who knows more about the Word of God than we do. We seek them out and we ask for their advice, opinion, and their counsel. And then also what we do as a result of that is take their advice, opinion, or their counsel. And we, in other words, we do what they say. And it's funny how many times, you know, people have come to me, I've told you this several times, but I'll tell it again because it's so pertinent. It happens over and over, 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 over again. Happens all the time. Somebody will come to me and say, well, what do you think about this and that? And, you know, they've come to me in the first place because, again, when you approach somebody, you're approaching them because you think they have information that you need to hear. And you're respecting their knowledge and their authority. And so people have come to me and said, what do you think I should do in this situation or that situation? And I tell them. And if they like it and it aligns with their preconceived notion or thought process, they typically do it. But it's very rare the individual that I'll tell them something that is completely different from what they wanted to hear. And they follow it. Typically, you know, what they do is they ask and then it's not what they wanted to hear. And yet, what do? Well, they go ask somebody else. And then that isn't the same information. Then they go ask somebody else, and they go ask somebody else. And they do the cherry-picking process until they get to an individual that says, this is what you should do. And that is what they really wanted to do or had in their mind all along. And therefore, they go and do it. And again, we are to be that type of individual. If we are going to ask somebody's opinion in regard to what we should do, and we've sought them out because they are a wise counsel, we should take their advice, which means apply the principles and precepts that they have given to us. Let me pause here for a minute. And remember, Job was out there, and he had some people that came to him and tried to give him counsel. And what? We found that two of them were all wrong, or three of them were all wrong, and one was absolutely right. But what's the difference in what I just said to you and what Job's situation? See, Job didn't go seeking their counsel. You see, these idiots came to him, and they said, oh, we're going to tell you what's what. That's a little different. Okay, that's now the other individual who is arrogant trying to tell you what to do. But the example I was giving you is when you go and seek somebody's advice, opinion, and counsel, because you know they've got something more that to offer than what you have in your own soul. And so when you hear the information from them, again, trust in that information. And then also, you know, search your scriptures in addition to that and find out what they said is absolutely right and correct, and then absolutely follow it. I don't know why I'm having a tickly throat tonight, but seems a little dry. Can you get me another bottle of water? So again, we see this example here of the naive one. We don't want to be that naive one. We want to be growing in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We want to have the knowledge, we want to have discernment, and we want to be that prudent individual. And so now we see the contrast. Let's look at verse 15, the second half. It says, but the prudent man considers his steps. What's in the hand? Oh, I get throat lozenges too and some other pills? I don't know. What am I supposed to do with those things? What are you trying to do? Just take them. These are wise counsel. Just take them. I suppose they're mints or something, right? Okay, thank you. Oh, that's good. Then I'll be giving you a real hallucinated message. All right, so here we have the contrast. Again, the prudent man considers his steps. And that's very different from the naive individual. Again, the naive individual, again, is the willy-nilly type of individual. They're the fluttery butterfly in life, and they're just floating around from here to there or the other thing. But this is the individual who has discernment and considers his steps. And that's a very important aspect that we're going to see here. Again, the man with discernment is what's in view. You see, considering your steps, typically what we've seen throughout this book of Proverbs thus far is the word derech, which is the word for way, the pathway, the direction, the way of life. And that is a real broad sense of how we are walking on our daily walk. But now when it talks about the prudent, it takes it down from not the path or the direction, but to every minute step that we take. Again, he considers his every step. In other words, each and every decision that we make during the day. Again, we think about, we apply doctrine to it. We turn to God, in prayer for his advice, his opinion, his counsel. We turn to the Holy Spirit to strengthen us, enable us, and give us discernment about our situation and comparing that with the Word of God. You see, every step you're leaning upon what? The Word of God. You're leaning upon the divine counsel that is found in Scripture. And it doesn't have to be an arduous, painstaking process. Again, it very simply is, what does the Word of God have to say about this? Or, you know, if you even need to, wear the bracelet, WWJD, what would Jesus do? And ask yourself that. What would Christ do in this situation? And then, therefore, come to a solution. We've talked about the faith rest drill, claiming the promises of God, mixing them together in faith, coming up with doctrinal rationales, and then applying a doctrinal conclusion as a result. Again, there are steps involved in that, but once you start doing it a few times, again, it's just routine for you. And it's like, boom, boom, here's what the Word of God says. Here's what a couple of scriptures together means. This is what, you know, when I think about these scriptures and the context in regard to that, the doctrine behind it, boy, it means this. And as a result of this, I should make that decision. and you go forward. So this individual, the prudent individual, they are living in the righteousness of God. They're considering their steps. They're walking according to the holiness of God. They're not living in the cosmic system. They're not being swayed by sin to walk away from the will of God and live in the cosmic system. They are living in the righteousness of God, experientially sanctified, not just wandering through life and trying to make it up as they go or think about, what is most pleasing to them. They are making good decisions each and every day based on the Word of God. And again, this book of Proverbs is just chock full. That's why it's taking us, a little bit time to get through this. There's just so much information here. There are so many fantastic principles for all of us to learn and to know. And it gives us principles about every aspect of life. And so all the information we need in regard to make wise decisions can be found within this book. And certainly, within the entire realm of scriptures, especially the New Testament that we have for us in the church age. And so we get to that word, or that just two words, his steps. Ashura is the Hebrew word here. And ultimately, you get the doubling of the SH there. And so Ashura is the Hebrew word, and it means the smallest unit of one's life. You see, Derek is talking about that overall process, the personal sense of destiny. Now we're taking it down to the smallest units of our life, the little steps that we take each and every day, putting one foot in front of the other. And as within AA meetings and things of that nature, their famous phrase is the Word of God tells us, live one day at a time, one day at a time. And then you can break it down from there, one decision at a time. You see, don't worry about tomorrow. Don't worry about this afternoon. Don't worry about tonight. Be concerned with what you're doing right now. Make a good decision. And again, in that decision-making process, there are long-term effects, and you want to be thinking about those. What are the consequences if I do this? What are the consequences if I don't do this? Again, every unit of our life, the smallest unit, is what's in view here. So again, we are to be the prudent individual. We are learning Bible doctrine. We are learning how to weigh the scales of decision-making within our lives. We are learning how to make good decisions. We are learning the faith rest drill, the faith rest technique. We are understanding the Bible and Bible doctrine. And we are also looking at our life situations from a divine perspective, a divine perspective. You see, Satan doesn't want you to look at life in regard to the divine perspective. He doesn't want you to look at life in regard to your Paula Tumor privileges and your eternal inheritance. He wants you to be thinking about today, and not just thinking about today, but be worried about today, be scared about today, be frightened about today. Because when we have fear, worry, and anxiety, again, the instincts within our nature and the sin nature will tempt us to grab onto the quickest thing that we have. Grab onto the quickest thing that can give me security right now, or that I perceive to give me security right now. And this is, an example, especially in many young girls and many young boys' lives. And, as you can see, I'm sure, within your own peripheries, and I've seen throughout my life as well. When the kids, if they don't have a boyfriend or girlfriend, they get very desperate. And they get desperate to find somebody. And they start to think about their future. Am I going to have a husband? Am I going to have a wife? Am I going to have this security in life? Am I going to have this, or am I going to get that? And what they do is they get scared about that. And so what do? They try to solve that problem by latching on to the first boy or girl that they can lay their hands into. And they overlook many of the faults and the problems and the difficulties that that individual is going to bring to the table and the long-term effect that that relationship will have. They overlook that. Why? Because they want security right now. I got to have it now. Rather than waiting on the timing of the Lord and waiting for God to bring your right man or right woman into your life. And so, they are looking to make decisions too quickly. And they are not having the divine perspective, the divine viewpoint. But the prudent individual does. They say, hey, I'm not going to worry about boyfriend or girlfriend. I'm not going to worry about life, and the details of life. What I'm going to do is trust in my Lord, that He will provide and that He will never leave me nor forsake me. And I'm just going to go day by day trusting in the Lord. I'm going to live in the tent. I'm not going to live in the house. I'm going to live in the tent, as we noted in the previous verses. And if he wants me to live in a tent today, again, you know, and that tent is situated here in Jerusalem, I'm going to live in Jerusalem. But if he wants me to pick that tent up and go live in Capernaum, I'm going to lift it up and I'm going to go to Capernaum. And I'll live there tomorrow. And the next day, he'll lead me to where he wants me. Just as he did with the Jews wandering through the wilderness for 40 years. He had them in the place he wanted them each and every day. And God will do that for you too. You see, Israel, as you know, is a macro of the micro spiritual life that we all individually live now. And as God worked for them, as God cared and provided and tended to them each and every day, he does the same for you. And so we just need to trust in him. We need to put our trust in him. And by doing that, how do we do that? By making prudent decisions each and every day based on his word, faith resting, divine perspective, dispensational understanding of the interpretation of human history and the Bible and the scriptures. And no matter how insignificant it may appear, again, even the littlest things, you know, turn it over to God. You know, he loves you. He's your friend. And also, he's your father. You know? Again, I know everybody hasn't, I don't know everybody in this audience, but anybody listening to my voice, you know, not all of us have had good parents in our lives, okay? But most of us have, okay? So you just think of how much your parents loved you, how much they did for you, how much they cared for you. And then think about how much more God would do for you, how much more he loves you, and how much more perfect he is than your parents were and what they did. As the scripture says, you know, our parents knew how to give us good things. How much more our Heavenly Father? How much more? So again, making good, prudent decisions based on our faith and trust in God, based on his word. And the prudent individual, what else do? They test their ways. They don't just jump into something. You know, they go through the scenarios. What if this? What if that? If I do this, that, and the other thing, then, you know, what will be the consequences of that? But if I do this, that, and something else, what are the consequences of that? And so we have to ask ourselves a lot of questions when we're making, you know, major decisions within our lives. And we should be asking similar types of questions at the more minor decisions within our lives as well, as we turn it over to the Lord. And that's what it's really all about, turning it over to the Lord. So we consider the prudent man considers his steps. The mature believer will be walking in the will and plan of God, thinking about the decisions that he's making every day. He does conform to godliness, you know, the true godliness and the true doctrinal principles that are found in the Word of God, especially what we call the Royal Family Honor Code. And what's the Royal Family Honor Code? We sum it up with the word grace. And we could probably add to that love. And again, anytime I think of grace, I think of love. So for me, those two go hand in hand, even though they're two different words. But again, the Royal Family Honor Code, grace and love towards one another, caring for each other, nurturing for each other, you know, thinking others to be more important than ourselves, giving grace to those who offend you, giving grace to the immature believer who may not be making all the good decisions, but being there for them to catch them when they fall or to encourage them to make good decisions on their way. So grace and love, along with having self-discipline. And again, as I say up on the board, this self-discipline becomes more progressive each and every day. I probably should be careful with that word progressive, because in the political realm, it means it's kind of a completely opposite thing than what we think of it to be. But progressive really means, you know, on an upward mobility, right direction, okay? And so what we find is that this individual's self-discipline is progressive in his march towards spiritual adulthood. You see, he's not falling into the same categories of sins that he did when he was a new believer. He's not repeating the same mistakes over and over and over again. He knows the weaknesses of his sin nature. And as I gave you the diagram of the strengths and the weaknesses, this lasciviousness and asceticism and the lust patterns of the sin nature, he knows what they are within his soul. And therefore, he is better equipped to overcome them with the Word and by the Spirit. and he progressively is sinning less each and every day, coupled with progressively having not to confess his sins as much each and every day. He's progressively praying more and more, turning things over to the Lord. He's also progressively faith resting in God, regardless of the situations. You see, every decision is weighed, and it's through experience that he understands which things deserve more attention than others. In other words, he begins to what? Master the details of life. And we've talked about that in the past in the edification complex of our soul. You see, some things in life, you know, put aside. You know, if you've got family nagging at you, oh, you haven't come and seen me for 3 weeks. Why don't you come see me? But yet that's church Sunday. No, I'm not going to go because I'm going to worship my Lord. That's first and most important for me. Oh, why don't you come see me on Sunday? No, I'm going to worship my Lord. That's more important. Again, there are things that deserve more attention. What deserves more attention? God. What deserves less attention? Our apostate families. Amen to that, right? So again, making, you know, good decisions, different decisions than they used to make before, progressively going forward in the spiritual life, and recognizing, you know, what's most important, what's your priorities in life. And again, as a prudent believer, as a mature believer, you know what's more important in your life, and you are categorizing those things and giving them the most attention. And if you can get to the other things, then okay, you'll do it. But if some of them have to fall to the wayside, so be it. No big deal. Yeah, somebody may be upset, or something may not have happened, or somebody doesn't like you as a result of it, whatever. You don't care because you're doing the right thing. You're doing the right thing, living for Christ, living for the Lord each and every day. And so this individual does not permit himself to be swayed, as we say, by every wind of doctrine. Let's turn to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Let's go to the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, Corinthians, Galatians, and then Ephesians. Let's start in verse 1. In verse 14 is the key verse to all of this, but I want to give you the whole context of what's going on here, and then we'll understand the principle. And really, the whole chapter really focuses on what we're talking about. All right, so in chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, entreat you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called." Again, walk in the manner worthy. What's that? Experientially sanctified. Not giving over to sin and sin temptations and being obedient to the Word of God. Excuse me. And not following every wind of doctrine, as we're going to see. In verse 2, with all humility. Again, humble in your heart. No, recognizing you don't know it all. You know, God knows it all. So turn to God. In gentleness, with patience, showing forbearance to one another in love. That's laying down your life for your friends. Verse 3, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Again, like-mindedness. We're going to see more of that on Sunday. Verse 4, it says, there is one body and one Spirit, just as also you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gifts. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. Two things there Christ did upon his resurrection, leading the saints that were in Abraham's bosom inside the earth, leading them to heaven, and then giving gifts to certain men that were here, or men and women in some cases, to certain gifts to men that were here on planet earth. In verse 9, it says, now this expression, he ascended. What does it also mean that he also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is himself also who ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. He gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists and some as pastor teachers. Those are all gifts that were only given to men. For the equipping of the saints, for the works of service, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. So all of that is talking about the gifts of Christ that he gave, you know, upon his resurrection and ascension into heaven. For what? The furtherance of the delivery of God's word. You know, the apostles, the evangelists, the prophets, the pastor teacher, these are the communicators of God's word. And why were these communication gifts given? So that everybody can grow in the knowledge of the Son of God to what? A mature man. And we would say a mature person. Remember, we use men, neuter general here, talking about the human race. All right? To a mature individual is what's in view here. To the measure of stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. So verse 14, as a result, and here's our verse, we are no longer to be children, tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness in deceitful scheming. Deceitful scheming. Again, on Sunday, if I get to it on Sunday, we're going to see more, but we've seen enough of the deceitful schemer in the book of Proverbs already. And again, the deceitful schemer is the false teacher of false doctrine, plus it's the person outside the church who's saying, you know, do something that's counter to the word of God. Again, this every wind and the craftiness of speech isn't just within our churches, it's inside and outside. And it's talking about all those false things that are leading you away from your relationship with the Lord. It says, but speaking the truth in love is our Royal Family Honor Code. We had to grow up in all aspects into him, who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body being fitted and held together by that which every joint supplies. Again, joint now typically thought of as the pastor teacher. According to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. This I say, therefore, affirm together with the Lord, that you walk no longer as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind. Now, the Greek word there for Gentiles is ethnos, and it just means a different ethnic group, okay? And so typically it's translated Gentiles, but it really is talking about, as we would say, Satan's cosmic system. That's kind of another synonymous phrase for what Paul was using here. And again, talking about the unbeliever or those inside of Satan's cosmic system, which could be believers as well. Verse 18, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart. And they, having become callous, have given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. But you did not learn Christ in this way, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self. Again, when the old sin nature was leading you completely, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit. Again, lusts, patterns of the old sin nature. In that you, being renewed in the spirit of mind and put on the new self, again, the new spiritual species, the new creature, the human spirit that is empowering you, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of truth. You see, there's a nature inside of you that's absolutely perfect that you can tap into. That's called your human spirit. Verse 25, therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you, with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not give the devil an opportunity. So again, we have a righteous anger that's in view there. Again, if somebody is doing something counter to the will of God, it's okay to get upset about it, okay? But do it without sinning, okay? It's okay to get upset and stand up for Christ, nothing wrong with that, but do it without sinning. All right, it says, and do not give the devil an opportunity. Again, if we take it too far and get emotional revolt of the soul, then Satan's got us and can lead us into all kinds of folly. Verse 28, let him who steals steal no longer, but rather let him labor, performing with his own hands what is good, in order that he may have something to share with him who has need. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification, according to the need of the moment, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. You see, if we're not operating as the prudent man according to the book of Proverbs, what are we doing? We're grieving the Holy Spirit. We're grieving Him. And then from there, we can go on to quench them, which means we drowned them out completely within our lives. And that's total apostasy. Verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted or compassionate, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ has also forgiven you. So again, with all that information, you see about the decisions that we make each and every day. How should I talk? How should I walk? How should I act? The Word of God gives us those instructions. As I'm going to talk more on Sunday about, you know, in our world today, there's no absolute righteousness because the Bible has been thrown out. And there's relative morality rampant throughout our nation. And it's whatever somebody thinks goes. And it seems like the individual now has more power than the collective whole. And if one individual says, well, I think homosexuality is right and I want to live that way, then the rest of us have to swallow it. And we have to abide by it. And again, or any other category of sin that the Bible tells us. Again, if one individual thinks it today, we all have to go along with it, it seems. And it's interesting, you know, getting into a little bit on Sunday or maybe next Tuesday. But, you know, when we talk about relative morality or relative righteousness, you know, the thing is that it's always moving. You know, it's not static. It's not in a state. It's always moving around. And what Satan does is he moves us a little bit into more immorality or more moral degeneracy. And then after that takes a foothold and we're all comfortable with that little bit of immorality, what does he do? Moves it up another notch. And then there's a little clamor at first, but then we all get comfortable with it and we're okay. And then he moves it a little bit further and a little bit further and a little bit further. And he is on a constant march to bring immorality and moral degeneracy into our lives. And it's there now. And we live that way today in our society. And so the question is, what march are you on? Are you on Satan's continual progressive march of immorality and degeneracy? Or are you going to be on God's progressive march of learning what the absolute righteousness and truth and absolute morality is all about, and learning about that more and more each and every day, and applying it more, and saying no to these other things more and more each and every day? What march are you on? What path are you walking? What steps are you taking? And we all have to ask ourselves that question, and we're accountable to God and God alone in regard to that. So let's go back to Proverbs chapter 14. And now let me give you a good conclusion here. Because as we conclude, this proverb is motivating the young believer, the immature individual, and even, you know, those that are growing and are mature. Again, we all learn from these things. But he's motivating us to listen to others critically and to participate in our decision-making process and have discernment. And he's doing that by giving us this warning of labeling the naive and the gullible and the careless. Instead, he wants us to be a careful individual, prudent and shrewd, as it were. And given our comparisons, you know, we can add to the first half of this verse that the naive, gullible do not pay attention to their lifestyle, yet the prudent who keep a wary eye against one false step, they do not rely upon human opinion and human viewpoint. And see, that's what we aren't to do. Not rely on human opinion and human viewpoint. And if God puts no trust in even His holy ones, because none is so pure and reliable as to merit His trust, how much less are human beings and their words reliable? According to Job 4:15. And again, we see Job's friends, you know, being a bunch of knuckleheads, giving him wrong information. And remember, he didn't ask for their opinion. He wanted to give it to him. But yet, in contrast, the prudent believer implicitly relies on God, both with reference to His message, according to Genesis 15:6, and His messengers in Exodus chapter 4 and Numbers chapter 14. You see, God has messengers that He sends out. those who do have discernment, those who have wisdom. And again, as Moses was the leader and the ruler and the priest, and Aaron was a high priest leading the congregation, you know, they had a message from God. Just as your pastor teacher has a message that has been prepared by the Holy Spirit for you. And as we know, you know, those two are inseparable. And we always have to compare what the pastor is saying with what the Word of God has to say on our own. And then run with that information. Just as Jonah was that type of messenger noted in Jonah 3:4, going to the Ninevites, and also reiterated for us in Matthew chapter 12. And by doing that, by heeding the message and the messenger, again, we are carefully discerning our each and every step. And we are learning to be that prudent individual. We are being wiser and wiser with the Word of God each and every day. And so in our overall theme of adorning the temple that we all live in, the tent that we are, and by walking by faith and not by sight, we see that the maturing believer has 13 things that has been given to him in verses 8 through 15. And so let's go through them right now. Number one, going all the way back to the first part of verse 8, where it says, the wisdom of the prudent is to understand his way. The first thing that the mature believer does, or the prudent believer does, is understand the direction of his life by means of divine viewpoint found in the Word of God. Again, discernment, understanding the direction that we're heading in, having divine viewpoint, not human viewpoint or cosmic viewpoint or someone else's viewpoint, but having divine viewpoint. What would Jesus do? What does God say about this? And again, that's how we should be operating and living. Then number two, in the second half of our verse, where it says, but the folly of fools is deceit. Again, the prudent individual, they aren't deceiving themselves. And they aren't deceived by other individuals as well. They have their eyes wide open. They have 20/20 vision, and looking forward, 20/20 vision in hindsight. They're not deceived by the sinful actions of others. And they're certainly not deceived by their own sinful actions when they pop up from time to time. You know, the folly of fools. You know, we all sin, okay? We do sin, right? Yep, every one of us sins. Our sins were taken care of at the cross. Absolutely, Jesus paid the penalty for those sins. And then God also tells us to confess those sins in 1 John 1:9. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us, not positionally, but experientially, from all unrighteousness. And so when our sins pop up from time to time, we need to turn it over to the Lord and not be deceived and think, well, that's okay. Ah, that's all right. I can still be spiritual and still do this type of sin. Can't be done. And that goes along with what verse 9a says, fools mock at sin, or the confession of sin, as we would say. But again, this, the prudent individual, they do what? They do confess their sins when necessary. You know, and this has been an issue, as you know, with several people that were ordained from the same pastor that I was ordained from years ago. And now they're teaching that you don't need to confess your sins anymore. And they've come up with a total harebrained scheme about changing your heart. And if you just change your thinking, you know, I was walking in sin and now I've decided not to, and I'm going to follow God again. And that becomes an acknowledgement and confession of sin all by itself. I mean, this harebrained scheme that they came up with. But ultimately, what they're not recognizing, that it's the grace of God that's done it all for them. And they also mock us. And they say, oh, confession of sin is a ritual. You know, and the problem was, these individuals never understood what the confession of sin was all about. It is not a ritual. It's something that God has given to us. It's a mandate by God that we ought to confess our sins to God the Father and name them to Him. And then experientially, we have cleansing from all unrighteousness. And we recognize that if we are going to change our direction from operating in sin to now walking in righteousness, we can't do that on our own. We can make a decision, but the grace of God needs to come in and cleanse us. And that's what the Word's all about. And the blood of Christ cleanses us. And without that cleansing, we aren't in fellowship with God, which means we don't have the filling of the Holy Spirit as well. And so the prudent individual understands that the confession of sin is not just a ritual. Let me just go through this routine so I get to the point and I get back to God. No, they understand what's behind it. And that is that I have sinned. I've sinned against you and you alone, Father, as David said, and as the prodigal son said. And I've recognized that sin. And now I want to walk with you. I want to have fellowship with you once again, which we can't do on our own. But God can, and He comes in and He gives us that experiential cleansing so that now we do walk in fellowship with the Lord, according to 1 John chapter 1, verses 7, and then all the way down through verse 10. The prudent man understands that. So again, if you're going to march towards progressive, spiritual maturity, or march progressively towards spiritual maturity, that needs to be an aspect of your life in recognizing what confession truly means. It is not a ritual. You know, it might have been for those idiots, but it's not a ritual. It's a reality. And then what do we see in 9b? What does it say? It says, but among the upright there is goodwill. You see, the mature believer is going to have blessing and favor from God and man. So you're going to have good relationships with people. You're going to have a fantastic relationship with God. Again, the favor of God for the prudent man. The prudent man also in verse 10, what does that say? The heart knows its own bitterness, and a stranger does not share its joy. You see, the prudent, wise, mature individuals knows that God knows the every detail of their heart. And you don't have to hide anything from God and turn everything over to Him. Give him your all. Give Him your whole soul. He already knows it. You might as well realize that He knows it and just give it to Him. And if it's your sin, give it to Him in the confession. If it's righteousness, give it to Him. If it's a decision, give it to Him. He knows the secrets of your heart. And the prudent man knows that, and he shares those things with God. If there's a sin you're struggling with, don't try to hide it. Don't try to mask it. Don't try to overcome it on your own. Turn it over to God and let Him lead you in that situation. Then in verse 11, it says, the house of the wicked will be destroyed, but the tent of the upright will flourish. This is that nomad mentality that we were talking about, living in the tent. We understand that we are blessed in time and eternity for living under our polituma privileges, our heavenly citizenship. That's what polituma means, our citizenship, which is in heaven. And we live in that as royal priests and royal ambassadors, which we also are in the church age. And we do that unto the Lord. And we aren't looking for the materialistic things of this world to satisfy us or to give us security, safety, and comfort. We look to God purely for those things. And if we have, you know, the riches of this world, great. God's blessed us. Let's use it. Let's enjoy it. No problem. But it's not our comfort. It's not our security. It is God. And we live unto God. Even with the riches, we live with God even in rags. Doesn't matter. We live unto the Lord. And we serve Him and we serve mankind. Verse 12a, there is a way which seems right to a man. And again, that was talking about the self-deception that we can bring to ourselves. It seems like a right thing because I've charted this way. And I, you know, and a lot of Christians, you know, I'm going to do this for the Lord. Yet it's the wrong time, in the wrong place, in the wrong situation. And it's not right. And they deceive themselves. Yeah, this is what I'm going to do. Oh, this is going to be great. This is going to be wonderful. And they ultimately get into a works program. But the prudent man, they're not self-deceived. You know, they're not just saying, because I thought it is right. They're seeking out the counsel of the wisdom of God's word. Then we see in 12b, it says, but in its end is the way of death. And what does the prudent man do? They avoid self-induced misery because they're not getting involved in folly and they're avoiding divine discipline in time. So God doesn't have to wake them up because they're already awake. They're already walking in His plan. So they avoid all of these things, which in and of itself is a blessing. Again, we all have problems in life. We live in Satan's world. We're going to have problems. Let's not give ourselves more problems because of self-induced misery and divine discipline. Let's avoid that altogether and walk in the righteousness of God. In verse 13, it says, even in laughter, the heart may be in pain, and the end of joy may be grief. Again, we have the concept of the secrets of our heart. But in that aspect, again, it's telling us to have discernment in regard to our fellow mankind. And even though they may be laughing, they may have a lot of heartache in their soul. And don't just blow it off and laugh with them and say, oh, they're okay, they're fine. Again, don't get an emotional revolt of the soul, you know, because of what they're displaying to you. But instead, continue to have discernment. And have your antennas up for that little sign that they may give you. That, yeah, they may be laughing, but really there's sorrow in their soul. And maybe you can help them. So again, we treat others with impersonal and unconditional love. That's what's in view there. As God is telling us about the secrets of the soul, again, He's telling us that for our own benefit in the first half, in verse 10. But now when we get into verse 13, it's so that we can apply that to other people and help and assist them wherever we can. Then in the 10th point, verse 14, the backslider, the first part, the backslider in heart will have his full of his own way. Again, this is that deceptive type of nature once again, but it also is telling us that we don't live life for ourselves. You know, the cosmic person, they're living life for themselves, and they're going to be full with that. And that's their reward. Their reward is paid in full, as the Lord said. They've received their reward here in this world, and there's nothing beyond that. So the prudent believer does not live life for ourselves. We live it unto the Lord, we live it unto others. And then I am third, if you want to say it that way. And then in 14b, what did we see there? A good man will be satisfied with his. You see, the good man who is walking in righteousness, the prudent man, will be satisfied with the life that he lives unto the Lord. God will bless him with that inner peace, happiness, and contentment. He'll have a life that is satisfied, a life that is fulfilled. He won't be saying, I should have done this, I should have done that, I could have done this, I could have done that. No, the saying I did do. I walked as best as I could, and I did what the Lord wanted me to do as best as I could. And as He opened doors and closed them in my life, I walked as He wanted me to. And you sleep well at night because you know you served the Lord. And then as we look at 15a, again, the first half, the naive believes everything. The prudent man is not deceived once again with what he hears and the things that are in this world. The prudent man is not deceived. He's got divine viewpoint. He can understand when, he's hearing the falsehoods. He's understanding when people are trying to take advantage of him or her. And he can cut, or she can cut right through any of that. And they are not deceived by what they see or what they hear. Again, we're not afraid of the train, you know, the bull charging us or the train roaring down the tracks at us. We're not afraid of those things because we see it or hear it. But we continue to trust in the Lord. And then finally, the 13th point is the last part of verse 15. But the prudent man considers his steps. You see, we prudently measure our every step to glorify the Lord in our life. And that's what it's all about. Walking in the will and the plan of God. So as we've noted, verses 8 through 15, the second section of Proverbs chapter 14, we've seen these fantastic principles of what to do and what not to do. And when we put it all together, this is what the prudent man should do. We should do these things. And we could call this our own 13-step program, if you want to do that. Okay, it's our 13 steps as to what to do to live the unique spiritual life unto God. All right, so we'll close there. We'll pick it up on Sunday when we get into section 3, starting in verse 16. All right, let's just close there with our heads bowed and our eyes closed in prayer. And Father, we just thank You for this time. We thank You for this opportunity to learn and grow more spiritually. We thank You for the words of wisdom that You provide for us each and every day. And we thank You for Your love and Your care and Your kindness and Your tenderheartedness towards us, Father, even though we are sinners. You know, You're always there to pick us up. And so, Father, we just ask that You continue to walk with us each and every day. You know, be patient with us. Continue to give us growth within our lives and lead us on the path that You would have for us so that we serve You to the fullest, glorifying You in all that we do. And so, Father, we ask that You give us travel blessings on the way home this evening. In the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, by the power of Your Spirit, we pray. Amen. And with that, you are dismissed.